Hi, David Sterry from Real Life here, and today I'm talking to Retro Talking Mix in Argentina with Lautaro.
¿Cómo están, amigos de YouTube? Bienvenidos a un nuevo video, una nueva entrevista en el canal. Hoy vamos a entrevistar a David Sterry del grupo australiano Real Life, así que quédate ahí. Real Life es un grupo australiano que en los 80 la rompió con un éxito llamado Send Me an Angel, lanzado en 1983. Una canción que tal vez incluso los fanáticos de Modern Talking recuerden, porque esa canción la interpretó Thomas Anders, el vocalista de Modern Talking, en alemán, mucho antes de conformar este gran dúo exitoso. Como decía al principio, hoy tenemos la oportunidad de hablar con David Sterry, uno de los fundadores de este grupo australiano, y vamos a estar conociendo un poquito sobre la banda y sobre este gran éxito mundial. Te recuerdo que si no estás suscrito al canal, puedes hacerlo en este momento haciendo clic en el botón que está abajo de este video. Y por favor, para no perderte ninguna de las novedades, activa la campanita de notificaciones. En primer lugar, vamos a conocer un poquito sobre los inicios en el mundo de la música de David Sterry.
When I was 10 years old, I got a guitar and I started doing some formal music lessons while I was, you know, very young. I love music. When I was very young, I heard the Beatles and the Rolling Stones and I thought, wow, that's fantastic. I guess I never really imagined that I'd be a musician. I sort of didn't do very well at school. I had no real ambition doing anything. But I kind of stuck with playing guitar, and by the time I got to high school, one of our English teachers decided to put a band together and just came out into the playground and said, "Hey, you, David, I know you play guitar, and this other person, I know you sing." Another person he knew that played the bass and a drummer, and he told us to form a group, and we did. And I guess I was about 14, I think. And the group was called Badge, which was named after a song by the band Cream that we're all big fans of when we were very young. So we managed to play at the school fete, and it was, you know, it was fantastic. We probably weren't very good, but we had a great time. And I guess from there, you know, I left school when I was about 16, and I did an apprenticeship in the printing business, which I hated. And I left the day that I finished my apprenticeship. And I still never imagined I'd sort of become a full-time musician or be able to have any success. I guess the big music at the time was prog rock and the beginnings of heavy metal, and I loved all that music, but there's no way that I could play it. So I spent a lot of lost years in my early 20s with no direction, and you know, I certainly wasn't trying to become a famous musician or anything. When punk came along in the late 70s, I, you know, wasn't really a big fan of that. I mean, I kind of thought, wow, this is, you know, it's exciting, but it's kind of not me. And then New Wave came along after that, and I was very excited by that. I thought, wow, this is, you know, you don't have to be able to play like a great prog rock player or a great blues player. There's something unique with this new music where it's got these fabulous new electronic sounds of synthesizers and guitars and great songs. There was bands like Magazine and Ultravox and XTC, and I thought, wow, I can sort of do something like that. So a friend of mine, very early one Saturday morning, when I was sort of a bit of a, I was on the dole and I was sort of couldn't pay the rent or anything, a friend of mine came around and knocked on my door very early and told me that there was an ad in the paper then I had to reply to this ad. It was from a keyboard player who was looking for a guitar player. And, you know, I thought, ah, yeah, sure. But I eventually rang the number, and the number was a guy called Richard Zatorski. And I guess at that moment, his life and my life changed forever, because we formed a band that would go on to become Real Life. And so that's kind of, yeah, from beginning to where it started.
A continuación, David nos va a estar contando sobre la formación de Real Life.
When Richard and I started, we just wanted to learn to write songs, really. We had no intention of forming a band. But eventually, I guess we decided otherwise, and we found a bass player and we had a drum machine, and we decided we could go out and play some of the pubs in Melbourne. I guess this was about a year or so after we'd started writing songs, and we started out calling ourselves A Private Life. But there was a band in Sydney that was called Private Lives, who said, you know, you can't come to Sydney with that name. So we had to change the name. But we were started out playing little places, and we'll be opening for some of the bigger Australian bands like INXS and Ice House and The Church and all sorts of people like that. And we were always trying to steal some of their audience. You know, my job was to kind of make them like us and be as charming as I possibly could, and bring them back to our solo shows we were playing. And we did that. And so we, after a couple of years, we'd sort of built this huge following, even though we didn't have a record or a record company or a manager, but we'd be playing on a cold winter Tuesday night in a pub in Melbourne, and the place would be packed. They were exciting days. The year before we got signed to our record deal, and all those nights opening for Midnight Oil and INXS are probably the happiest days of my musical life, actually. There was this, you know, we were fearless but formless, and we're having a lot of fun. It was great times.
Ahora bien, vamos a conocer un poco sobre este gran éxito de los 80s llamado Send Me an Angel.
So Richard and I were under quite a lot of pressure to kind of come up with something. And then one day we were driving, or one night we were driving down to a show down the coast in Melbourne. And, you know, he'd handed me a cassette, and I had a little Walkman. And I listened to it, and I heard da 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 da, the opening line of Send Me an Angel. I thought, ah, oh, he's done it. He's got it. Richard's got the music. I've got to come up with the words for this. And I think in the car on the way down, I came up with the title, Send Me an Angel. And yeah, we arrived at Geek and had to play a show. So the next day I got home, and I swear I'd finished the rest of the song in like about 20 minutes. It just sort of went and wrote itself, I think. And we had no great expectations of it. I mean, all the people around us, all the people that advised us, like managers and record companies, said, oh yeah, look, it's great, but you know, if it gets into the top 20, you'll be very lucky in Australia, and no thought of it being an international hit. So, you know, it came out and it was a hit, and people loved it, and, you know, our lives changed overnight. We, you know, played on the TV shows, and, you know, we played bigger shows, and all of a sudden the bands that we were supporting were supporting us. And about 12 months later, you know, we were sort of recording an album to go around that song, and it started to take off in America, and it became, you know, a hit over there for the first time. And we went over and toured in 1984. We went and toured. So we started in 1980, and by 1984, Angel had come out. In 1983 in Australia, and then in 1984, we went and toured America with Eurythmics, and did, I think, 32 shows with them. And quite a lot of shows with a band called Berlin, who are still friends of ours. And halfway through that tour, We got word that Send Me an Angel was out in Europe and it was number one in Germany. And we were like, wow, Germany, you know. I mean, it was just from living in, you know, the wrong side of town in Melbourne to having your music played all over the world was just, you know, pretty amazing. And it still amazes me to this day. It's still, you know, I still can't believe it. But anyway, so we had to go to Germany to sort of support the record over there, and it became a hit in the rest of Europe as well. And, you know, it was just a phenomenal success. It was just, you know, I still feel so lucky to this day. And I know how much people love the song, and I'm sort of so very proud of it as well.
Una de las preguntas típicas que hago acá en el canal es acerca de si volvería el tiempo atrás, si cambiaría algo o no de su vida o de su carrera profesional. Y esta fue la respuesta de David.
Would I change anything if I could go back in time? There was a lot of bad things happened to us. Our record company was liquidated and went bankrupt, and we were sort of in terrible trouble for a long, long time. I guess I would change that. I wish we'd toured more. But by the same token, I mean, most people in the music business know that we had a pretty rough time. But I'm so grateful for the time we had. You know, I got to travel the world, got to meet some amazing people. I still get to play music. People still want to see real life and hear not only the old songs, but a whole lot of new songs. We never broke up. I mean, we were without a record company or management for a long, long, long time, and became an independent band. And that was a pretty interesting journey as well, trying to sort of just do all the promotion and management ourselves. But, you know, we've never sort of broken up. I mean, I'm the only person left from the original band, and whoever's standing behind me now is real life. So we've never broken up. There's always been a record somewhere. And there's always been something on the records that's kept me wanting to sort of do some more. I've never felt like giving up. So it's been a long journey, you know. It's been 40 years or something now, just about 40 years. And I'm not sick of it yet. I still love music. I still love playing. I'm so grateful to have had the career that I have.
Por último, vamos a conocer si hay nuevos proyectos, si hubo nuevos discos en este transcurso de la pandemia y post-pandemia, y un mensaje para todos los fans.
So, in the middle of the pandemic, I made a new album, a new real life album, and it's called Sirens, and it looks like this. It's on CD. And it's on vinyl as well, and it's kind of a concept record. I was a very big fan of an album called Low by David Bowie many, many years ago, where one side was practically one track instrumental, and the other side was just some pop songs, some 3.5 minute pop songs. So this is called Sirens. It's about the legend of the Sirens, and so one side is called Sirens, and it's kind of has five little parts, but it tells sort of a story of someone who wanted to hear the sirens sing and was washed up. No one survives hearing the sirens sing. And the other side is a whole lot of, you know, is five other pop songs, and we've been playing them, and they go down very well. So when you announce that you're about to play a new song, people go, oh no. But as soon as they hear it, they like it with this album. So I'm very proud of it. It's kind of a new wave, prog-tronic, electronic, lots of synthesizers, lots of distorted guitar, and some of the best songs I've ever written. So it is on vinyl as well, but it's very hard to find. There was only 300 made. And as well as CDs, but you can find it on Spotify or iTunes. So it's Sirens by Real Life, and I'm very proud of it, and I hope you like it. I hope you have a listen to it and you feel the same way. So This has been David Sterry from Real Life talking to everybody in Argentina and everybody else that gets this show. And thank you for all the feedback about Real Life's music over the years. Thanks for coming to our shows. I would love to play in Argentina. And hope to see you one day. Thank you so much. Ciao.
Bueno amigos, esto fue todo por hoy. Espero que les haya gustado este video. Déjenme en comentarios su opinión, denle me gusta y compártanlo con todos sus amigos. Así seguimos difundiendo este gran contenido referido a la música de los 70s, 80s y 90s. Nos vemos en un próximo video. Chau chau.